Please start.
Good afternoon, one and all. We are going to present the case on hypertensive disorder of pregnancy. Coming to the case presentation, 22-year-old Paini Gravida, at 36 weeks of gestation, whose LMP lies on 8/11/2020 and EDC on 15th of August 2021, who is a BCom graduate by education and presented with complaints of edema of legs for the past 1 week and headache and blurring of vision for the past 1 day. History of present illness: high blood pressure was detected at 32 weeks of gestation on routine antenatal checkup, and patient was started on oral nifedipine 10 mg twice daily, and patient was on regular follow-up since then. The headache was present in the forehead and occipital region. It was not associated with vomiting and not relieved by taking rest. There is a history of blurring of vision, and her blood pressure was found to be 160 over 110 millimeters of mercury. So patient was admitted, tablet labetalol 100 mg twice daily was added, and magnesium sulfate regimen was initiated. There is no history of altered sensorium, seizures, dyspnea, snoring or hoarseness of voice, epigastric pain or vomiting, oliguria and bleeding manifestations. Past history: there is no history of hypertension, heart disease, diabetes mellitus, kidney disease, epilepsy and thyroid dysfunction. Family history: her mother is hypertensive and there is no history of gestational hypertension or preeclampsia in family members. Personal history: she follows a mixed diet, her bowel and bladder habits are normal, there are no addictions. Menstrual history: she attained menarche at 13 years of age, she had regular cycles and normal flow, no dysmenorrhea was present. And last menstrual periods was on 8th of November 2020. Marital history: she was married for past 1 year, non-consanguineous marriage. Obstetric history: her pregnancy was detected by urine pregnancy test and confirmed by obstetric ultrasonography from a nearby hospital. She was on regular antenatal checkup and her pregnancy was uneventful until 32 weeks. So her first trimester, second trimester were uneventful. And at 32 weeks, she was detected to have high blood pressure. And then she was started on oral nifedipine 10 milligram twice daily and was on regular follow-up. Sir?
I think Bhuvaneshwari will go over the general examination.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Summary: 22-year-old Paini Gravida, gestational hypertension detected at 32 weeks of gestation, started on tablet nifedipine 10 mg twice daily, and now she admitted with edema of legs for past 1 week and headache, blurring of vision and high BP. Then added on tablet labetalol and mixed salt regimen was started. And her mother is hypertensive. Then on general examination, patient is conscious, oriented, afebrile, no pallor, no tachycardia, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no pedal edema, no lymphadenopathy. Generalized edema present, including facial puffiness, bilateral pedal edema, sacral edema present. Height is 160 centimeter, weight is 80 kilogram, BMI is 31. Peripheral venous access is difficult, arterial collateral is adequate, spinous process difficult to palpate because of edema. Vitals: pulse is 66 per minute, regular rhythm, good volume, vessel wall not thickened. Blood pressure 162/96 millimeter mercury measured in the right upper limb in sitting position, 150/90 in the left lateral position. JVP is not elevated, respiratory rate is 16 per minute, and saturation is 97% in room air. Airway examination: mouth opening 3 finger, malamati class 2, temporomandibular joint can insinuate 1 finger, thyrometal distance is 6.5 cm, bilateral nasal pattern is normal, no deviated nasal septum, neck movements normal, breast enlarged, thyroid normal. And cardiovascular examination: precardium is normal, apex width palpable in the left fourth intercostal space in the mid-clavicular line, there is no palpable thread. S1, S2 is normal in mitral, right aspect, pulmonary and aortic areas, there is no murmur. Respiratory system examination: upper airway normal, trachea is central, chest movements and expansion equal on both sides, bilateral air entry equal, no normal vascular breath sound, no added sounds. Central nervous system examination: mental functions normal, cranial nerves normal, sensory and motor system examinations within normal limits, No cerebellar dysfunction or meningeal irritation. No hyperreflexia. Obstetric examination. Fundal height correspond to 36 weeks of gestation. Longitudinal line. Cephalic presentation. Fetal heart rate 160 per minute. Summary. 22-year-old primary gravida, gestational hypertension detected at 32 weeks of gestation, started an oral nifedipine 10 mg twice daily. At 36 weeks of gestation, she admitted with pedal edema for one week and headache and blurring of vision for one day. At the time, IBP was recorded 160 bar 110 and added on tablet labetalol and Mexal regimen was initiated. Mother is hypertensive. Diagnosis: 22-year-old primary gravida, 36 weeks of gestation, severe preeclampsia with impending symptom, on tablet nifedipine, tablet labetalol and magnesium sulfate, single life fetus in cephalic presentation.
Good. So that's your history taking and the examination. Anything else you would like to add upon? That's you've completely covered all the examinations. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So why do you say you have made the diagnosis of a severe preeclampsia? Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what are the points in favor of a severe preeclampsia?
Yes, sir. So the patient was admitted with a blood pressure of 160 bar 110 millimeters of mercury, despite being on treatment on oral nifedipine 10 milligram twice daily. And also patient had new onset of cerebral visual disturbances in the form of headache and blurring of vision. So because of these two, three features, we categorized it as severe preeclampsia, sir.
What are the other possible differential diagnoses?
So severe preeclampsia?
Yeah. See, it is basically a raised blood pressure with other symptoms. So, how do you classify the hypertension in the pregnancy?
Classification, according to American College of Obstetrician and Gynecology, hypertensive of disorder of pregnancy is classified into gestational hypertension, preeclampsia, chronic hypertension, chronic hypertension superimposed on preeclampsia.
So why don't you think that the other possibilities are there? It's a chronic hypertension or a gestational hypertension or a combination.
Sir, as her blood pressure was detected after 20 weeks of gestation, initially she was diagnosed to have gestational hypertension at 32 weeks of pregnancy. And now at 36 weeks, patient presented with blood pressure 160 by 110 millimeters of mercury, despite being on treatment nifedipine. And also patient had headache and visual disturbances, blurring of vision. So these three findings correlate with severe preeclampsia, sir. And patient was not hypertensive before 20 weeks, so we ruled out chronic hypertension.
So you have taken the history of...
Yes, sir.
Previously, she was not hypertensive. Yes,
there is no history of hypertension.
Okay. So that means it is a possibility is more in favor of a preeclampsia and impending symptoms. Okay, fine. Right. So, what we are going to discuss in the next, say, about 1 hour or so is the pathophysiology of this preeclamptic toxemia, what it was called earlier, or the hypertensive disorders and their management. And for the benefit of all the other postgraduates also, what I would like to say is the majority of the examiners expect a answer for how to manage this particular case, the history that you have taken in the examination. This is number one. And the focus is on what you practice in your institution, because the practice pattern varies from institution to institution, say from a different kind of across the country. So therefore, a question that is often asked in your institution, how do you manage such cases? So I want both Dr. Priya and Bhuvaneshwari to take note of this, and also for the benefit of all the other postgraduates. Okay, there will be some kind of a controversies, and yes, you can answer that. These are controversial issues that if the examiner does not agree, better to keep quiet at that particular point of time. So this is a general introduction what I would like to give. And the next point is, see, any case management, it is absolutely necessary that you have a sound theoretical knowledge of that particular disorder so that your management becomes more easier. It is Yeah, it is a general anesthesia. You just put an endotracheal tube, you relax and then manage. It's not that. Okay. So therefore, we'll be discussing a little more issues about theoretical aspects also in this. You agree, Dr. Mubarak?
We'll go along with that, in that line, sir.
In that direction only. Okay. All right. So how do you define preeclampsia, Dr. Priya?
So preeclampsia is defined as new onset of hypertension and along new onset of hypertension more than 140 by 90 millimeters of mercury, which is measured at two intervals, more than 4 hours apart, at least 4 hours apart. And along with proteinuria, more than 300 milligrams per 24 hours, protein creatinine ratio more than 0.3, and urine dipstick 1+.
Okay. So is there anything like a mild, moderate, severe or something like that? You classify?
So preeclampsia can be classified into without preeclampsia, without severe features, and severe preeclampsia. In preeclampsia without severe features, that's just a BP more than or equal to 140/90, and along with proteinuria of more than 300 milligram per 24 hours, and protein creatinine ratio more than 0.3, and 1+ urine dipstick. In preeclampsia with severe features, there is blood pressure more than or equal to 160 bar 110 millimeters of mercury, thrombocytopenia with platelet count less than 1 lakh per microliters, and pulmonary edema, impaired liver function with elevated liver enzymes of more than AST more than 70 international units per liter, or with severe persistent right upper quadrant or epigastric pain, pulmonary edema, and
preeclampsia is classified either as a mild or a severe. There is nothing like a moderate preeclampsia. So it is either mild or a severe one. Severe form, yes, you have to manage quite aggressively. Preeclampsia, mild case also can be there. Okay. So with regard to the pathophysiology, I think if I can add a little, there is a lot of controversy. Probably we may not spend much time on that. It is what is the basic pathophysiology involved in this? In hypertensive disorders of the pregnancy?
First one is abdominal presentation, failure of cytotrophin plus to invade the uterine vessels. Then second one is excess release of anti-angiogenic factors like soluble FMS like tyrosine kinase and soluble endoglide, which scavenge the vascular endothelial growth factor and placental growth factor, it leading to widespread endothelial dysfunction. Then there is thrombaxin and prostacyclin imbalance. Then immunological intolerance between the fetal, placental and maternal tissues. Then right. Genetic predisposition in monozygotic twins with HLA DR4.
Okay, so there are, the pathophysiology is of this preeclampsia is a evolving subject. A lot of investigations are going on in that. But the thing remains is there is abnormal inadequate invasion of the tropoblast into the spiral arteries. That remains, but how and why it happens is a matter of investigation. So let's not go right now into that particular thing. All right. Okay. What are the common risk factors that are involved in the development of this that we know, the development of preeclampsia?
The demographic risk factors include advanced maternal age, more than 35 years, Black race and Hispanic ethnicity. Genetic factors include family history of preeclampsia, history of placental abruption or fetal demise in previous pregnancies, or partner who has fathered preeclamptic pregnancy in another woman. And behavioral factors include cigarette smoking has a decreased risk reduction in preeclampsia. And maternal factors include, or obstetric factors include multiple gestation and hydrocephalus. Maternal factors include systemic disease, include diabetes, hypertension, or chronic kidney disease, antiphospholipid antibody syndromes, or systemic lupus erythematosus.
Yeah, in many instances, it may not be possible to pinpoint or identify what the risk factors are there. Okay, it is only the pregnancy that may be only factor. And among the pregnancy, what is important? It is the placenta or the fetus that is the cause for this?
Placenta is the cause.
Why do you say so?
Abnormal placentation is the basic pathology of preeclampsia.
Correct. So that is the reason. And another reason is even in the absence of a fetus, like in a molar pregnancy, still the preeclampsia can be seen where there is no fetus. There is only placenta, you know. So therefore, it is often said that it is the placenta is the culprit here in this particular development of this preeclampsia. Okay, so you know the pregnancy is a normal physiological process and it involves several physiological changes that happen during the pregnancy in the first, second, third trimester of pregnancy. I'm sure you are fully aware of those things. Okay, let's not go into that. But what is important is, what are all the systems this pre-eclampsia or eclampsia it affects? What the systems are affected and how it is different from a normal pregnancy? Can you enumerate the system-wise one by one so that each of them that is relevant to the anesthesia practice?
Cardiovascular system, there is increased vascular tone, increased sensitivity to vasopressors, so leading to hypertension, end organ ischemia. Then hemodynamic changes in a severe untreated preeclamptic patient will have widespread vasoconstriction. And there is low cardiac output, low CVP, low pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. In treated preeclamptic patient will have systemic vascular resistance will be high. Increased pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, it is disproportionate with the increase in central venous pressure.
So that is the most important problem that we see in hypertensive disorders and the preeclampsia. The one is colloid oncotic pressure and leaky capillaries and increased systemic vascular resistance. Okay. And in addition to that,
what about the intravascular volume?
What happens to the blood volume in this? It is
intravascular volume will be depleted.
It is what is typically described as a contracted blood volume. Okay, so what about the other systems? Hemodynamic is there. Then what are the changes you see in the respiratory system?
In airway and respiratory system. Airway, there is increased mucosal capillary engorgement and increased chance of tissue friability and increased risk of bleeding. And also, there will be, because of pharyngeal, laryngeal and subglottic edemas, there will be tracheal diameters and laryngeal diameters would be decreased. And all these factors are seen in normal pregnancy. These factors are exaggerated in preeclamptic pregnancies and increasing the risk of airway obstruction, difficult intubation or failed intubation, and increased risk of hypoxemia in these patients.
Okay, so the respiratory system is also severely affected because of the edema that is seen normally in the pregnancy, and that gets worsened in this particular case. And in addition to the common things that happen in the routine pregnancy also, like decreased FRC and the
increased oxygen consumption.
Okay, Bhuvaneshwari, what are the central nervous system changes you see?
Central nervous system, patient will have severe headache, hyperreflexia, hyperirritability, okay, and eclamptic convulsions. And visual disturbance. Visual disturbance, hemorrhosis, scotoma, and blurring of vision. It is because of failure of autoregulation. It leads to hyperperfusion and vasogenic edema. It is more prominent in posterior circulation, that is posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. These patients will have headache, vomiting, and visual disturbances. It is not always associated with hypertension. Diagnosis made by MRI.
So, in the pre-eclampsia, milder form, the central nervous system may not manifest, although they are present. But in a severe form, all this central nervous system primarily predominates and that will be prominently visible in these cases. Any coagulation abnormalities you see in these patients?
Yes, sir. The most common hematological abnormality seen is thrombocytopenia in these patients, sir. Apart from which, there is widespread platelet activation, agglutination, and deposition leading to microthrombin formation, which can result in end organ damage. And also, there is increased risk of disseminated intravascular coagulation, particularly in the setting of severe liver disease, fetal demise, or abruptio placentis. And that can result in either a hypercoagulable state or resulting in thrombosis or a hypercoagulable state result because of platelet consumption and clotting factors consumption resulting in hemorrhagic complications.
Right. So basically, it is a case of a prothrombotic state. Pregnancy is a basically prothrombotic state. And over that, some of the other problems also you do see in these patients. Okay, so what are the other changes? Any other systems are involved?
Hepatic system, there is periportal hemorrhages and fibrin deposit in the hepatic sinusoid. patient will have right upper quadrant pain or epigastric pain and subcapsular hematoma or hematoma of the liver. Then patient may can develop HELLP syndrome, hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelet count.
Right. So the hepatic system also, once again, is it seen in a milder form or it is mostly seen in the
severe
preeclampsia?
Yeah. Okay. So that is what about the other systems?
In renal system, sir, because of the renal vasospasm, there is decreased blood flow to kidneys and resulting in decreased glomerular filtration rate and oliguria. And also proteinuria is also a manifestation, mainly because of increasing pore size and chart sensitivity would be different in preeclampsia. Apart from it, there will be increased serum creatinine because of the decreased creatinine clearance.
So the renal blood flow is affected, the glomerular filtration rate is affected. So there is what is the reason for the proteinuria? Why is it occurs?
Increase in pore size of the capillary and chart selectivity is alteration of chart selectivity, sir.
Okay, so these are some of the common systems that are involved in the preeclampsic toxemia.
What about the fetoplacental
circulation? It is impaired. It lead to fetal intrauterine growth retardation, and there is increased sensitivity to oxytocin.
Okay, so the system of central nervous, the cardiovascular system, hemodynamic circulation is affected, the airway and the respiratory system is affected, central nervous system is affected, and the hepatic and the renal system. So practically you can say all the systems of the body are affected by this particular thing, the preeclampsia. So therefore it is very, very essential that you keep all these factors in mind when you are anesthetizing such patients, right? Okay, so next is how do you optimize? Okay, this is the patient. The patient is in this particular case, already they have optimized this patient and to a great extent, the blood pressure is brought under control. So if you are given an opportunity to optimize the patient before she comes for either the labor analgesia or for the section, for the delivery, how do you optimize this?
Okay.
What is the definitive treatment for the eclampsia or preeclampsia?
Termination of pregnancy, sir.
See, it is a termination of the pregnancy itself. So straight away, do you want to take up for termination or you want to optimize this patient?
No, sir. I have to optimize the patient initially, sir. Hmm. Sir, we'll focus initially on the maternal and fetal surveillance and we'll rule out features such as end organ damage like acute renal failure, pulmonary edema, risk of eclampsia. And then also, at the same time, we'll focus on the fetal heart rate and fetal monitoring also is simultaneously done. And then we'll manage the acute hypertensive crisis with intravenous antihypertensive agents. Injection labetalol 10 to 20 milligram IV bolus is given, followed by 20 to 80 milligram every 20 to 40 minutes to a maximum dose of 300 milligram. Or it can be given as 0.5 to 1 milligram per minute infusion can be given. And or hydralazine 5 milligram IV or IM bolus followed by 5 to 10 milligram IV every 20 to 30 minutes. In addition, sodium nitroprusside and nitroglycerin infusions can also be...
One second. Let me interrupt you. So let me come back to my original statement. How do you manage such case in your institution? That will be the question. So what
yes,
common practice you do...
Sir, we initially start with
labetalol. Go and you will be a party for it. So what do you do? How do you administer orally the labetalol you use commonly or you use other drugs? What are the common drugs used to control the blood pressure in this or minimize or bring down the blood pressure?
Oral medications.
How do you use? What drugs do you use?
Tablet labetalol. It is a non-selective alpha beta blocker and selective alpha blocker. It is initiated 200 to 2400 mg per day in a 2 to 3 divided doses. Then nifedipine it is a calcium channel blocker, a selective renal arteriolar vasodilator. 30 to 120 mg per day orally in a 2 to 3 divided doses, sir. It is commonly, these both drugs are commonly used in our institute.
So levetiracetam and the nifedipine are the two commonly used oral drugs that that are used in your institution by the obstetricians or yours. In case if this patient lands up in a obstetric ICU, if you are asked to manage, now the option is what are the other drugs that you use? See, once in the obstetric ICU, the patient is having a severe hypertension.
Yes, sir. Sir, we manage with intravenous.
What you describe. Then what are the drugs? You have managed any kind of such cases?
Sir, actually, these patients are obstetric. People manage these patients, sir. So
okay.
We are usually called for seizure control and
right.
Hypertension.
Okay. What are your theoretical knowledge about this? How do you manage this?
Sir, intravenous antihypertensive agents are used for management of acute hypertensive crisis.
Okay, what are those drugs, intravenous drugs you use in ICU?
Sir, IV intravenous labetalol or intravenous hydralazine, sodium nitroprusser infusion or nitroglycerin infusions are commonly used, sir.
All of them?
Yeah, sir.
Used. Sodium nitroprusser. Can you just tell me the dosage of them? How do you administer?
Sir, intravenous labetalol, 10 to 20 milligram IV bolus, followed by 10 to 20 to 80 milligram every 20 to 40 minutes up to a maximum dose of 300 milligram high or 1 to 2 micro milligram per minute infusion. Hydralazine 5 milligram IV or IM bolus followed by 5 to 10 milligram IV every 20 to 30 minutes.
Or how the action is different from labetalol and hydralazine? Are they the mechanism of action same or different?
So labetalol is a non-selective beta blocker and a selective alpha blocker, sir. Hydralazine is a arterial dilator, sir.
Yeah. Direct vasodilator. Okay. What are the other drugs that you use?
Sodium nitroprusside infusion can be used, sir. 0.3 at a dose of 0.3 to 0.5 microgram per kilogram per minute, and can be used in incremental doses of 0.5 microgram per kilogram per minute up to a maximum dose of 5 microgram per kilogram per minute. But we don't use this preferably because as a first choice, sir, because of risk of fetal and maternal cyanide toxicity with higher dose infusions and with prolonged duration.
Kept in mind the fetal effect, fetal cyanide toxicity should be kept in mind when you are using the sodium.
What is your target control of BP?
Sir, target control is systemic blood pressure, systolic blood pressure of 120 to 160 millimeters of mercury and diastolic blood pressure of 80 to 105 millimeters of mercury. Mean arterial pressure should be reduced in 15
minutes. Does it apply in all the patients or does it depend upon the hypertension, the previous hypertension of the patient?
Sir, blood pressure is reduced in a controlled manner, sir, like 15 to 25% of mean arterial pressure. Of initial mean arterial pressure, an abrupt decrease in blood pressure is avoided, sir.
Why? What is the reason for that?
Sir, it can result in because of these patients' autoregulation would be set at a higher range, and sudden decrease can result in and ischemia of the vital of organs, sir.
So, whatever the blood pressure you want to bring it down, it should be a gradual. Even in the ICU, it should not be a very rapid change in the. Because the auto-regulation will be already altered, right? So, have you ever used dexmedetomidine in these cases?
For control of BP, we have not used dexmedetomidine in these cases.
There are some reports published, but there is no definitive information about the use of dexmedetomidine. But there are reports that are published in the journals. Okay, that may not be there one. Okay. Any other drugs you would like to use other than this as an anesthesiologist?
Nitroglycerin.
Yeah.
Nitroglycerin.
Yes.
And remifentanil can be used.
Remifentanil is another new drug that is available in the anesthesiologist armamentarium that also has been tried with the variable success.
Are beta blocker available in the theater, no? Rapidly acting?
Esmolol is another drug that can be used. So these are some of the drugs. What is your target? Where do you want to stop it?
Target systolic blood pressure is 120 to 160 millimeter mercury and diastolic is 80 to 105 millimeter mercury. To decrease the initial MAP to 15 to 25% from the baseline.
Okay, set a target for
around 140 bar 90.
Say around 140 plus or minus. Yeah, it's a better target. Okay, so that's how you manage the blood pressure in this hypertensive management. What other systems you would like to manage in this optimization?
Yes, sir. Seizure prophylaxis with magnesium sulfate is initiated, sir.
So seizure prophylaxis is a very, very important if the patient is having any imminent signs. So how do you manage that?
Various regimens are available. Pictured regimen. It is first 4 gram IV bolus, 4 gram IV bolus followed by 5 gram IM each buttocks followed by 5 gram IM alternate buttocks every fourth hourly. Then Sussman's regimen, 4 gram IV IV bolus followed by 1 gram per hour infusion. In our institution, we are following
KFOG
regimen. It is 4 gram IV bolus over 10 to 20 minutes followed by 5 gram IM in each buttocks followed by 1 gram one gram per hour infusion.
Okay. What's the regimen?
Mechanism of action, magnesium, it is NMDA antagonist. It will increase the seizure threshold. It will improve the cerebral blood flow. Other effects, it is an anti-hypertensive, central CNS depressant, anti-hypertensive effect, tocolytic and bronchodilator. During infusion, we have to monitor patient mental status, urine output, respiratory rate and patellar reflex. Because magnesium has a narrow therapeutic index.
Also, placental transfer is possible and it can result in fetal heart rate variability and fetal muscle tone will be decreased and fetal respiratory paralysis, respiratory depression is also possible.
Okay, so that's right. So both the another common regimen is a Pritchard regimen that is also followed in various institutions in addition to what you are doing it, but it definitely both of them have got a similar result. And how do you monitor the toxicity? Clinically, how do you monitor? And biochemically, how do you monitor?
Clinical signs like patellar reflexes, respiratory rate, urine output, and mental status is monitored, sir.
Okay. And what is the biochemical investigations? How do you monitor this? What is the...
Sir, serum magnesium level is monitored.
Yeah, what is the normally therapeutic range and what is the toxic ranges?
The normal level of serum magnesium is 1.7 to 2.2 milligram per deciliter. The therapeutic level is 5 to 7 milligram per deciliter. And toxicity begins when the level exceeds 10 milligram per deciliter, sir. Initially, it begins with patellar reflexes are lost when the levels are more than 10 milligram per deciliter. Respiratory paralysis occurs more than 15 milligram per deciliter. Pulmonary arrest with more than 20 milligram per deciliter.
Okay, remember that.
What are the anesthetic problems of in patients on magnesium?
It will prolong the non-depolarizing neuromuscular block action, and it will cross the placenta, and it will produce decreased heart rate and beat-to-beat variability and fetal respiratory depression. Then it is a tocolytic chance of PPS.
Postpartum hemorrhage is also present. So uterine relaxation.
Any effect on the central nervous system? Depressant effect?
Central nervous system, it's a depressant.
Any drug interactions are known?
Sir, magnesium sulfate and rifampicin can produce, they can produce synergistic effects. And also because of non-depolarizing agents, it should be used cautiously because of the neuromuscular prolonged blockade action of magnesium sulfate. And also it should be used cautiously in patients with hyperkalemia and with those with renal dysfunction and digitalized patients.
What are the common drugs that are affected by this? Which neuromuscular blocking drugs are most affected?
So mostly non-depolarizing neuromuscular blocking drugs are affected, sir.
Like Vecronium, Mivacurium, and Atraclip.
Okay. So, therefore, you need to be a little careful. The most important thing is nifedipine and the Maxal both are used together in most of the cases and they will be potentiating the action of each other. So, nifedipine potentiates Maxal and Maxal potentiates the nifedipine action. So, therefore, you need to be careful in choosing the dose of this particular drug. Okay. So, that is the... Okay, so that you have to be a little careful about as far as the the so this is how the these are common things, right? Any other things, drug optimization you are using, like steroids, do they become part of our treatment? Any role for this to manage?
Sir, those patients presenting in less than 34 weeks of gestation period, we administer corticosteroids to promote fetal lung maturity. Betamethasone is preferred over exemethasone, and it's given in a dose of 12 milligram, two doses over 24 hours, sir, 12 hours apart.
What is the drug that is commonly used in these patients?
Betamethasone.
So some people even tried exemethasone, but it is found that betamethasone is more effective and useful. So 12 milligrams used two doses. Okay, so once you optimize these patients, anything else is there, Dr. Mubarak, to optimize the patients?
Suppose the patient even with on medication throws a convulsion and you are called for, what will you do?
Once a patient has thrown convulsions, we have to initially manage the airway, breathing and circulation status, sir. So first airway is managed, patient is put on the left lateral position and jaw thrust is given, and also a soft lubricated nasopharyngeal airway can be inserted. If the patient has stopped breathing or apneic, we can support the ventilation with assisted ventilation with back mask ventilation, and we have to apply monitors, saturation probe, and watch for the oxygen saturation. And for circulation, we have to secure an IV access, and we have to frequently monitor the electrocardiogram and blood pressure. And in case if the BP blood pressure is high, we have to manage with antihypertensive agents. And for seizures, we have to start magnesium sulfate, 4 to 6 gram IV bolus, followed by 1 gram per hour IV infusion. And if it is persisting seizures, another 2 gram IV bolus can be given. And if it's still retractable seizures, we can choose other additional agents like phenytoin 15 milligram per kilogram, or benzodiazepines like benzodiazepines, diazepam 10 milligram IV, or sodium thiopental 50 milligram IV can be used.
Can the patient throw convulsions after delivery?
Yes, sir.
How long you will continue the magnesium sulfate regime?
Magnesium sulfate is continued until 24 hours after the delivery, or after the last eclamptic seizure, whichever is later.
Okay. So these patients, if they are in the obstetric ICU and likely to come to the OT for termination of a pregnancy, what are all the monitors that you use, routine monitors and the special monitors?
Routine monitors including electrocardiogram, non-invasive blood pressure, pulse oximetry, these are used, sir. In case a patient has additional complications, we'll look for invasive blood pressure monitoring.
Okay, well, what are the indications?
Indication.
Do you use imaging monitors routinely or any specific indication?
No, sir. We don't use routinely. Only
acute hypertensive crisis, then pulmonary edema, patient is having oliguria, and planned use of rapidly acting vasodilator, and
then
about urinary catheter, is it an invasive monitor or not? We monitor the urinary output.
Yes, sir.
So urine monitor, hourly urine output monitoring is an excellent monitoring tool, which is very simple and minimally invasive. Okay, so that should be done in all the cases. It will be done. It will be catheterized routinely, but then you have to monitor hourly urine output. That gives a very good clinical status of the patient. Okay. And then the other ones, it's a common this thing. I have seen some of the postgraduates telling, yes, the moment there is a hypertensive disorder or the preeclampsia, they say radial artery cannulation and the CVP monitoring. These are not indicated in the mild cases, and even in the moderate cases, only when you are aggressively trying to control them. Okay. And the neuromuscular monitoring, if it is available, that will be an excellent tool. If it is available. Yeah, that will also
capnography when there, especially if you are using general anesthesia, capnography
that has to be kept in mind. Okay, right. So Any other problems that you are likely to see in these patients in addition to the cardiovascular and the hypertension and the other one is
coagulation status of the patient.
How do you monitor, how do you measure, what are the investigations you do for that?
Baseline platelet count should be done, and platelet trend of platelet count is more important. So in those patients diagnosed with severe preeclampsia, you have to do at least daily platelet count is done. And coagulation, other, if platelet count is less than 1 lakh, we have to look for other coagulation monitors also, like prothrombin time, activated partial thromboplastin time, and fibrinogen level. For coagulopathy.
When do you get this platelet dysfunction and all? Commonly, in which conditions? These are likely to go for coagulopathy more. Which conditions?
If the patient
associated with liver dysfunction, what do you call
the
condition?
Health syndrome.
If the patient had health syndrome, patient will have impaired liver function.
What do you mean by health syndrome?
It is characterized by hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelet count in patient with preeclampsia. Hemolysis, it is characterized by abnormal blood smear. It is showing cystocyte, burr cells, and echinocyte, and elevated increased bilirubin more than 1.2 milligram per deciliter, and LDH more than 600 international unit per liter, elevated liver enzymes, AST more than 70 international unit per liter, LDH more than 600 international unit per liter, and low platelet count is less than 1 lakh per millimeter.
Okay, have you heard of classifying this thing, Mississippi classification?
Mississippi classification is based on
platelet count, sir. Basically on platelet count, it's classified into class 1, 2 and 3. In class 1, platelet count is less than 50,000 per millimeter cube. Class 2, 50,000 to 1 lakh. And in class 3, 50,000 to 1.5 lakh. And in class 1 and 2, AST would be more than 70 and LDH would be more than 600 per international units per liter. And in class 3, AST would be more than 40 international units per liter and LDH would be more than 600 international units per liter.
So basically, it takes into consideration three platelets, the liver enzymes ALT and AST, and the third one is LDH. What does it indicate? LDH, what does it indicate?
Hemolysis.
So it is an indicator of hemolytic status. This thing. Okay. All right. So, what are any other differential diagnoses you can make for the HELLP syndrome?
Yes, sir. acute fatty liver of pregnancy, acute cholecystitis, appendicitis, hemolytic uremic syndrome, thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, and nephrolithiasis.
So those things also should be kept in mind. It is not that always you should think only in terms of a HELLP syndrome. The other possibilities also will be there. That's especially the acute fatty liver, the pregnancy. So that is okay. So that's how you have to analyze these patients. The patients you diagnose and then you try to optimize before they come to the operation theater. What are all the role of anesthesiologist, in which circumstances you are involved in the management of these cases?
Sir, in providing labor analgesia or in management of acute hypertensive crisis or other maternal obstetric complications, for providing anesthesia for emergency and elective cesarean sections, and for ICU management, for the management of complications, and for maternal and neonatal resuscitation.
Okay, if you are called in to conduct or provide a labor analgesia for this particular mother of what you are describing, what is your approach? How do you proceed with this?
First, I'll evaluate the patient and I'll ensure the coagulation status of the patient. If the coagulation profile is normal, I'll go for a lumbar epidural.
What are the options that are there in your mind? One second, Gunikari. What are the options? Labor analgesia, what are the options that are there in your mind?
Non-pharmacological methods and non-pharmacological methods are there, sir. Yeah. Among non-pharmacological methods, we don't prefer. And among pharmacological methods, there is intravenous opioids or inhalation agents like Entonox or Heliox can be used. Mm-hmm. And for intravenous opioids, we can use remifentanil infusions as a patient control analgesia or...
Which is got a better, more advantageous in these particular patients? Which method is more advantageous?
Sir, lumbar epidural analgesia is more advantageous in these patients. Sir.
It is, but what are the advantages? What are the supposed advantages of lumbar epidural analgesia in this
It decreases the basal metabolic rate. It increases the maternal catecholamine release, and improves the uteroplacental circulation and increased intravenous blood flow. Sir.
So, what are the precautions that you take? What are the concerns that you have before you institute an epidural or a neuraxial block?
The patient's coagulation parameters should be normal. Only then we'll approach for the epidural.
What do you mean by coagulation parameters? What are the things you see?
The platelet count should be more than 80,000 international units per liter. If it is between 50,000 to 80,000, we'll evaluate the patient with the platelet trend of platelet count as well as other coagulation parameters like prothrombin, APTT, and fibrinogen. And if it is less than 50,000, we won't go for a neuroaxial block technique.
What is this?
Platelet count that is important?
No, sir. The trend in platelet count and the last 1 to 3 hours, platelet count in the last 1 to 3 hours is more important.
And platelet functioning also may be affected. So you have to monitor the any other clinical bleeding manifestations also. Suppose you have the oozing from the intravenous site or something like that, you should not.
Okay, sir.
Despite your platelet values.
Is there any role of aspirin in these patients?
Aspirin, low dose aspirin, it is commonly recommended because it will inhibit the thromboxane A2 in the platelets, it will inhibit the platelet aggregation.
Okay, so some of the patients may be on aspirin, but do you want to go for a neuraxial block in these patients or no?
Yes, sir, low dose aspirin is not a contraindication for neuraxial blockage.
Provided the platelet quality and the count both are good, if you are satisfied with that, then you can go for it. What are the other options in addition to lumbar epidural analgesia? What are the other options?
Sir, intravenous opioids.
Neuraxial block. Can you give a spinal block for these?
For analgesia, lumbar epidural.
Yes.
Yes, sir. We can give a spinal block also, sir, but motor function is not preserved, sir. So
what is walking epidural? I have heard walking epidural.
Yes, sir. Walking epidural is walking with low dose, final dose is given so that motor function is relatively impaired, relatively preserved compared to.
What is the commonly used drug that is preferred in these cases for providing the labor analgesia?
Sir, here we use injection bupivacaine, sir, 0.125% in our institution, sir.
0.125. What is the other recommended dose? What is the any disadvantages of using higher concentrations?
Bupivacaine has got a cardiovascular CNS toxicity ratio, sir. So there is more cardiotoxic compared to bupivacaine.
No, I am asking about the concentration.
If you are using higher concentration, it will cause motor block also. And patient will have hypotension.
Okay, you are more worried about the motor blockade. What is the importance of motor blockade? Why you should avoid in any labor analgesia, motor blockade should be avoided?
Because if the patient has to participate in the labor process, her motor function should be preserved, sir. Only sensory block is required.
It is preferred so that the mother's participation in the delivery will be affected if you use higher concentrations. So commonly preferred dose, initially you use 0.125 followed by 0.0625 will provide sufficient analgesia. And any additives you would prefer in these cases?
Fentanyl, 2 microgram.
Additives to the neuraxial blockade?
Fentanyl.
Like fentanyl or
2 microgram per ml.
I think we have lost touch with them.
Hello, sir.
Sir, in our
institution, any additives you think of?
Fentanyl can be used as additive.
What is the dosage you prefer, fentanyl?
Sir, 1 to 2 microgram per ml of 1 to 2 microgram per ml is used, sir, of the local anesthetic.
Okay, so that also it will help you in lowering the concentration of the local anesthetic that is used. Can comfortably use 0.0625 if you are adding some additives like fentanyl. So that is beneficial. Some of the, even recently, some reports are published wherein they have used dexmedetomidine also, but it is yet to be stabilized. So definitive reports are not available in that. Okay. All right. So if this patient, that is for the labor analgesia, we've got another 15 minutes of a time, 15 or 20 minutes, right? Okay. These patients, if they are coming for cesarean section, say elective cesarean section, what is the plan of anesthesia you have in your mind?
Plan of anesthesia?
Options of anesthesia include single shot spinal technique or graded epidural or combined spinal epidural or general anesthesia. But in this patient, we prefer...
You concentrate on your patient and what is your preferred. You cannot give 3 or 4 techniques for a single patient, no? You are considering this patient and what is your choice?
Okay. Single shot spinal anesthesia would be, subarachnoid block would be considered technique of choice.
So you prefer spinal anesthesia?
Sir, provided there is no coagulopathy and her intravascular volume status is good. And there is no other contraindications for regional anesthesia.
Why did you know?
What are the other contraindications? What contraindications you mean? You said coagulopathy. Yeah,
coagulopathy. I could acute hypertensive crisis, intractable seizures, hypovolemia, or hemodynamic instability, or patient refusal.
See, I said elective cesarean. Yeah, Mubarak, please go ahead.
Tell me the advantages of choosing your technique of spinal anesthesia, some single shot subarachnoid block. Why did you choose? Advantages.
It will maintain the uteroplacental circulation. It will improve the avoid stress response to intubation, and airway problems are avoided. Then we can provide.
Can be counter for, provided if the hemodynamics are stable only. If the hemodynamics are unstable, all these things are will counter. What about the technical easiness? Which is easier, an epidural or a spinal subarachnoid?
Subarachnoid block is technically easier, sir.
Technically easier. It has got definite endpoint. You are used with the technique, but though it has got disadvantages. Okay.
So, what are the concerns you have if you are using a general anesthesia compared to spinal anesthesia? What are the advantages of general anesthesia and what are the concerns?
Anesthesia concerns, patient factors, that is full stomach, even patient had 8 hours of fasting, we should consider as a full stomach patient, then difficult airway and aorta cavel compression, difficult.
No, aorta cavel compression can occur in both the categories of anesthesia, whether neuraxial block or general anesthesia, you have to take precautions. Concerns for general anesthesia.
Sir, intubation, accelerated hypertensive response during intubation and extubation.
Because the airway, blood pressure.
Difficult airway management, which can result in failed intubation or difficult intubation, sir.
Airway is difficult, and when it comes to these conditions, it becomes more difficult. You have got generalized edema, contracted blood volume, your intubate responses. So added pregnancy itself is a high risk, and the airway becomes more difficult and intubation. But still, what are they? There are definitely indicators for general anesthesia. What can be even with these conditions? Sometimes you may have to opt for general anesthesia. What are those conditions?
The coagulopathy, hypovolemic status, intractable seizures, ongoing hemorrhage. Patient.
Okay, so when there is a definite or a suspected hemorrhage, you have to be way more cautious in avoiding the neuraxial blockade. Okay. Right. So, what are the thing, if you are using general anesthesia, what are the precautions that you take in these patients?
Precautions.
How do you manage this? See, like a contracted blood volume, even the airway is always considered as a difficult airway. Even if clinically it is not apparent, it must be considered as a difficult airway, especially all pregnancies, especially the preeclamptic patients. So what are the special precautions you do take in this?
Okay, sir. Before starting the procedure itself, I set the table with difficult airway cart ready, all the necessary equipments required for it, and as well as for maternal and neonatal resuscitation equipments would be, and drugs would be kept ready, sir. And in addition to which, I expected an exaggerated hypertensive response. So for that, I'll give an intravenous labetalol prior to induction to decrease the hypertensive response during intubation.
Yeah. What about that?
And a rapid sequence induction is preferred in this. It will be done in this case, sir, because of the full stomach status.
Yeah. Well, see, all mothers, like what you said earlier, should be considered as the full stomach patients. Like RSI already, it was discussed in the last talk. So let's not go much into the depth of it. Okay. See, what are the, in case if you are using the general anesthesia, the possibility of general anesthesia, how do you pre-medicate these patients?
As I suspect a difficult airway in these patients, and pre-medication would be with a short acting, pre-medication would be for aspiration prophylaxis would be given, sir. And apart from that, glycopyrrolate 0.2 milligram IV is given, sir, to decrease the secretions. And
prophylaxis you use?
Aspiration, sir, injection ranitidine 50 milligram IV and injection metoclopramide 10 milligram IV is given, sir.
You do routinely in your institution?
Yes, sir. These are routine use, sir.
Okay.
We don't give 0.2 molar. Sodium citrate is not commonly used. We don't give sodium citrate here, sir. 0.2 millimolar sodium citrate. We don't use.
Don't use? Why do you don't use? Why do you are not preferring that? Have you seen how many? Of anybody has seen the sodium 0.3 molar sodium citrate?
We haven't seen
it. It was available in the market about 15 to 20 years back for a very, very, very short duration, and it was never used. What are the reason why it is not popular? What are the disadvantages of using it? Theoretical question I'm asking. It is good you are not using it.
The particulate agent, sir. Is that particulate agent?
How much volume you have to consume for that?
30 ml should be consumed.
Yeah, it is a large volume. That is one. 30 ml you have to give it. And what is another one? Single important. In addition to the volume, it tastes very, very bitter taste. So it is not at all an acceptable one. That is the reason why it appeared for a very short time and just disappeared. It never picked up in the market. It is only for a theoretical considerations. Okay, it is not
another scenario. See, you have a functioning epidural and the obstetrician decides to go for an emergency cesarean section with a diagnosis of fetal distress. Which are the conditions where you can continue with the epidural, and which are the conditions where you cannot continue with the epidural for emergency cesarean section in that condition?
Sir, when the fetal, if there is fetal distress which requires an emergency cesarean section, it depends on the urgency of the procedure, sir. If it is a fetal distress and fetal heart rate is less than 100 per minute, then we have to, we cannot wait for the epidural to act, sir. I mean, epidural to attain the block, sir, level of block. So in the those scenarios, we prefer a general anesthesia technique.
When there is dire fetal distress, when you have some time to establish the blockage and functioning, you can continue with that, with the epidural. Then what about the volume status of the patient?
Yes, sir. Intravascular volume status should be adequate, but the clinical evaluation of that is difficult, sir, in case of an emergency.
But you can see the response of the patient to the labor, to the epidural, how the patient responded, and your monitoring systems and your urine output will give a rough guide whether what is the volume status. And if the hypertension is not controlled, uncontrolled hypertension, or if there are any signs of, and another problem is you cannot preload or you cannot give faster fluid. And if there are any signs of pulmonary edema or any signs of lung involvement in pulmonary edema, better not to go for a
regional
taking. Okay.
Okay. See, what about the combined spinal and epidural? What are the advantages or disadvantages? It's good. Do you practice that?
Sir, we practice a single shot subarachnoid block here, sir. Okay. But combined spinal epidural is technically more difficult, because in case of this patient with sacral edema, the placement of an epidural and functioning of the epidural, we won't be definite about that, sir. And depends on the urgency of the procedure also. If we have given a low dose spinal technique and we are opting for an epidural to give additional doses, if the patient is in a dire fetal distress, we won't have time for the epidural to attain the level of block. Otherwise, if it is an elective procedure, combined spinal epidural can be given with a low dose spinal drug, and amount of spinal drug can be, dose can be reduced, and additional drug can be given by epidural to attain the level of block if it is an elective procedure.
There one major disadvantage is when you are combining a epidural with the spinal, you don't normally give a test dose for epidural catheters. Placement. Okay. Oh, yes. Final. Then, if you are not sure, you whether your epidural works or not, that is the major disadvantage of a combined spinal epidural in these cases. Okay. What is the test dose? The drug you use? That's a quite a controversial one. What drug epidural proper placement of the epidural catheter?
In our institute, we are using lignocaine 2% without adrenaline. But current studies are showing we can use lignocaine with the adrenaline as a test dose.
You can use, if this fetal heart rate status is good, you can still use, because it is more safer to use adrenaline than not using it. Yes, definitely. Plain lignocaine also is beneficial. But there are controversies. Some people agree, some people do not agree. There are recently the reports appear that you can go for the thing. Okay. All right. How do you manage this spinal anesthesia for cesarean section, elective cesarean section?
Hypotension.
Yeah. How do you conduct a spinal anesthesia for a cesarean section?
I'll evaluate the patient. I'll explain the procedure. I'll evaluate the patient and look at the investigations, current investigations.
Concentrate on the differences or the special precautions in this situation, in a preeclamptic patient. For example, the preloading. What about anything regarding preloading, regarding the falling blood pressure management, those things. Yeah.
The restrictive co-loading is done in these patients, sir. 1 to 2 ml per kg per hour is given, sir. So that we have to aggressive co-loading can result in, because of the capillary leak and decreased plasma oncotic pressure, higher risk of pulmonary edema is there. So we prefer a restrictive co-loading.
Yeah.
And hypotension is managed with
what about the chance of hypotension? Is it more or less?
So recent studies says with single shot spinal it's negligible, sir. Hypotension, risk of hypotension is negligible.
When compared to the other non-hypertensive mothers or non-preeclamptic mothers, is it the same or different? The incidence of hypotension, is it same or different?
The same,
sir.
Same.
Yeah, it's way what's so much of a doubt. You are doing day in and day out, you are doing the preeclampsia patients in your hospital, no? So there is no difference as far as the incidence of hypotension is concerned. And what are the preferred drugs that you use for the treating the hypotension?
Vasopressin, epinephrine, and ephedrine can be used. Ephedrine are used, sir, but both are used in a lower dosage, sir. Phenylephrine 25 to 50 microgram as starting dose, or ephedrine 5 to 10 milligram as a starting dose.
What is the reason why you want to use in a smaller doses?
It's an exaggerated response to the catecholamines in preeclamptic patients.
There will be exaggeration. So therefore, this patient may not require a larger dose, and they are quite sensitive. With the regular doses or even the lesser doses, they do the blood pressure.
What are the precautions while using oxytocic drugs in this condition?
Oxytocin can be used, but metazine should be avoided in severe preeclamptic patient. We can use a carboplast also. Oxytocin 3-unit IV bolus, wait for 3 minutes, and assess the response. If the uterus is not contracted, we can give another 3 units IV and watch for uterine contraction. If the uterine contraction is inadequate, give another dose of 3 units IV bolus.
So totally, how many doses do you use? Maximum how many doses?
Three doses maximum.
Maximum 3 doses of 3 international units bolus injections. Okay.
This method is absolutely contraindicated. Suppose the patient is not responding to oxytocin, prostaglandin, and uterus is still flabby and planning for obstetric hysterectomy.
Intramyometrial prostaglandin F2 alpha can be given.
Okay. So the patient can go for a complication like obstetric hysterectomy. What are the added risks in this situation?
Sir, as a patient,
is not contracting despite of oxytocin. And
as a patient is a volume contracted state, there is higher risk of bleed and risk of coagulopathy is also there. There is higher risk of bleeding in these patients and sudden hemodynamic collapse should be anticipated, sir.
And suppose this happened in a patient having an epidural in situ, you have given spinal epidural or epidural. Will you proceed with the epidural in that condition for obstetric hysterectomy?
No, sir. We'll proceed with the general anesthesia, sir. Because of hemodynamic instability anticipated.
What are the problems in inducing general anesthesia in such a patient who is having a functioning epidural for an obstetric hysterectomy?
So these sort of questions come
when you have cleared, you have passed, and you have reached a high level, only these sort of questions come. So be confident and try to answer. Okay.
Sir, the hypotension the sympathetic blockade results in hypotension, sir, depending on the level of blockade. So with an additional induction, use of induction agents, which are myocardial depressants, there is increased risk of hypotension and collapse, hemodynamic collapse.
Effect of anesthetic drugs and positive pressure ventilation can
contribute to
collapse in an already compromised patient who is hypovolemic, had a cesarean section. So while induction, you have to take all the precautions of using minimal intravenous agents, and you can choose, sometimes you may have to use even ketamine like agents despite of pregnancy because the hypotension is there, or you can mix with ketamine small dose with propofol, or you can use etomidate, and you should have IV access adequate. You have to start IV extra lines. You may, if you don't have an invasive monitoring, you may have to start to put on invasive lines once the patient is stabilized. So these are certain things which you have to consider while inducing a general anesthesia on the top of a failed spinal or a failed epidural, or on the top of a functioning epidural for complications like an obstetric hysterectomy. Whatever postoperative care.
Few more minutes left. A little information about what is eclampsia. How do you define eclampsia?
Eclampsia, it is defined as new onset of seizure or persistent coma in a pregnancy, or unexplained coma in a pregnant woman or in a postpartum period in a woman with signs and symptoms of preeclampsia without any pre-existing neurological disorder.
Okay, so it is necessary that both should be there? Both the components,
no.
Seizure and the coma?
No, sir.
Seizure or unexplained coma? Seizure or unexplained coma, or both? Any of the two components can manifest as a thing. So how do you manage these cases? I think already we have discussed that. It's the termination of the pregnancy only.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so that is the only definitive treatment. But till such time, you already discussed about the thing. Any other things, Dr. Mubarak, we need to discuss in this?
What about the postoperative care of this patient? How do you monitor this patient after a cesarean section?
So these patients are monitored in high dependency units, sir, with control, with strict monitoring of the blood pressure and urine output and intravascular volume status, sir. And also
the strategies for postoperative analgesia?
Sir, intravenous opioids can be used, sir, or transverse abdominis plain block, ultrasound guided transverse abdominis plain block in case of general anesthesia.
What about use of NSAIDs?
NSAIDs are not preferred, sir, because it can result in a platelet inhibition, sir,
and it will aggravate the hypertension also.
Okay, so it's a what are the other problems? Have you heard of a postpartum eclampsia?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
What is postpartum eclampsia?
So in those patients who presents with eclampsia for the first time in the postpartum period, usually within the first 7 days after delivery.
Normally, how long this present the preeclampsia or eclampsia persists in the postpartum period?
So 12 weeks.
12 weeks of postpartum.
So it can be there up to 12 weeks. So therefore, what is the importance of this managing the postoperative analgesia? It symptoms do persist in the postpartum period also. Therefore, it is very essential that you maintain a proper analgesia so that there is the hypertensive response will not be exaggerated in these mothers. Okay, that should be the strategy of this. Okay. Any other things, Mubarak, or should we invite any comments from our colleagues? The other.
In one chat box, is it what about the time organizers, Jiddin? I think we have almost one question I have seen in the chat box, press and PET differences. I think that, have you seen?
Press and PET, okay.
Yeah, that's one question when this thing has come here.
Press.
I think the term, I think I assume that PET to be preeclamptic toxemia. That terminology has been taken out actually. It is not used nowadays. I think it is not the PET scan. So I don't know whether what they meant, whether it is preeclamptic toxemia.
The preeclamptic toxemia or toxemia of pregnancy is no more used. It is the preeclampsia is the common term that is used.
Oral drug of choice in postpartum eclampsia. One question has come. Oral. I think when there is postpartum eclampsia, oral drugs are not going to be effective. You will have to continue with magnesium for further time, and you may have to reassess the neurological status to find out any fresh events have occurred for the occurrence of eclampsia like that. You will have to do a detailed neurological evaluation. Or you can give other and control of hypertension like with labetalol. Those angles also has to be considered.
Yeah, there is another question, that is management of a patient going for a DIC. CDIC management, yeah, the only answer here is a termination of the pregnancy. That is the first one. And then the is a one of the case of consumption coagulopathy, no? It's a DIC. What's a double catheter technique of epidural analgesia? There's another question. You would like to answer, Dr. Priya, double catheter technique?
Sir, spinal micro catheters can be used, and in addition to the epidural catheters, we don't use these things here.
No, what they mean is double catheter is the one of the things that was described earlier, the placing catheter, one catheter for the liver and the other one for the second liver. One in the thoracic level and one in the sacral level. So that's what was there. But it is no more valid because you never predict where the catheter moves. It is assumed that it moves caudally, cephalad, but there is no guarantee that it will go in that direction. And it is not used anymore, that double catheter technique. It's the only thing is single catheter, we do make the patient sit or semi-recumbent position in for the second stick. Okay. Right. Any other expert comments on these discussions that we had?
Seniors, they can unmute and make their comments.
Pardon me, Binil?
They can unmute. Participants can unmute and directly discuss with you.
Yeah, anybody can join. Fast track spinal can we use in preeclamptic patient with fetal distress? Yes, fast track, what exactly we mean?
Spinal anesthesia.
Rapid sequence spinal analysis. Yeah, the conditions remain the same. If there are no contraindications for a spinal anesthesia, yes, the answer is the same. Then dural puncture, epidural. Yeah, dural puncture is a possibility is much higher, especially when the mother is having the, especially during the contractions, there is a possibility of the dural puncture is more. So therefore, it is commonly recommended. The common question that is another common question that is asked for a examination is, when do you place the epidural catheter? We do place the epidural catheter when the mother is expected to go into the labor or when she is not in active contraction. During that time, you place the catheter, but only thing is you activate when she is depending on your institutional protocol, either 5 centimeters or 7 centimeters in a multi and 3 centimeters in a primary, that's whatever is followed. But the thing is, if you want to avoid the dural puncture or the intravascular placement, it is better you use it when the mother is quiet and still yet to get the labor pains. So that's the thing. Okay, any other things are there?
The question on epidural sieve. What is an epidural sieve?
Epidural sieve. That's probably the epidural block will not be acting. You know, any particular patches that will not be acting. And the exact reason is not known. But possibilities are that when we try to use some air for testing purposes, in such a situation, it may be there. I think that may be the answer.
Can I come in, Mubarak sir?
Yeah. Mallikarjun sir.
Yeah. Epidural sieve, usually he has said that when a patient has undergone previous cesarean section and for the next delivery, she is undergoing an epidural analgesia. So if she ruptures with the epidural analgesia, will the patient complain of pain? So this epidural sieve is the term used that when a patient has a rupture of uterus with an epidural analgesia, but still the pain is appreciated by the patient when the patient has a rupture, and this is called as epidural sieve.
Okay, that's a rupture of the uterus.
Yeah, when the previous suture gives way. Generally, when you give epidural analgesia, you are supposed not to appreciate any pain. But it is said that when you have given epidural analgesia for a patient who has undergone previous section, and if there is a give way in the uterus, the patient will still complain of pain. And this is called as epidural sieve. It is just like the patient comes out of this one to appreciate the pain.
That's one of the, that's a possibility, yes. I do remember having read this particular thing. Okay. Thank you, Mallikarjun, for enlightening that and refreshing.
Namaskara.
Yeah, namaskara, namaskara. It's nice that your presentation was good. I did follow it.
Thank you, sir. And nice seeing you also.
Yeah.
Nice seeing you, sir.
Yes, definitely. Virtually, at least we are seeing, if not physically. Okay, can we time our epidural to the cervical dilatation? That is another question. What exactly it means? Yes, we have to, but it has no role in the cervical dilatation as such. Cervical dilatation is a hormonal process, but we can time it at that particular time. Or what we say, it's in the primes, I said, it is for a 3 centimeter dilatation.
Sir, one thing regarding cervical dilatation, when the epidural works, the pain-induced inhibition of cervical dilatation is cut and there may be an enhancement of cervical dilatation. That is, we have experienced and we have seen there is, though it is mainly hormonal. So pain-induced inhibition is not there and labor can fastly progress. And your epidural should not be overdosed to produce the motor blockage. So properly, yes. when the patient is having severe pain, that factor is there.
Okay, dural puncture, epidural technique. I did not understand the question. Okay, in fetal distress, how can we enhance the onset of action of epidural? Yes, one of the methods, already you have the epidural is in place. Yes, there is a the addition of any of the analgesics. That may be controversial one in these cases. The only thing is the concentration can be increased. Anand Bangir has asked this question, it looks like. Vinil, that's...
When there is a severe fetal distance, we don't actually advise or advocate epidural.
No, enhance the onset of action. That is the rapid onset of action.
Another thing is...
The answer can be because... Yeah.
Sir, in personal experience, I find that I have found that this, and our teachers used to say, when you add freshly mixed adrenaline to lignocaine, it acts faster than the ready-made lignocaine with adrenaline. So, our professor of education always used to advise to add freshly mixed adrenaline. So that is one reason of fast, and we never had any problem of onset when you use such solutions.
Okay, so Edward Johnson has clarified that what Mallikarjun has told, that is the answer, that's right. The pathological pain is perceived by the mother when she is under the epidural block. A good epidural block, still she is feeling, that is placental abruption or the uterine rupture. Yes, that's right.
That is one of the reasons that your analgesic dose should not be too much. When your motor block, your analgesic dose should be minimal, and patient can have perceived some amount of pain, because if you give a higher dosage, this type of pain may not be perceived and you may miss it. So that's also there.
And DP.
Sir.
Yeah.
Dural puncture that is done intentionally in epidural analgesia.
Okay.
And is recently they are mentioning that intentionally with the smallest puncture needle, maybe 29 size or something, you make a disc, the onset of analgesia is very good. Immediate onset of analgesia, and it is recommended when you are putting epidural, intentionally you make a small puncture in the dura. Okay. So you get immediate analgesia, because one of the action of epidural is through the subarachnoid.
Yes.
There are four mechanisms of action. One is through a subarachnoid, one is directly the nerves passing over, one is, of course, the drug gets absorbed and action, and the other one is paravertebral, like that. And here, intentionally, a small puncture is made, and you get a very good immediate onset of analgesia to be supplemented by the epidural, what you are doing afterwards. So that is recommended presently.
Yeah, it is nothing but an extension of a combined one. The earlier,
yes,
the
yes. Final extension of a combined, yes.
Yeah.
Here, a small dose they give with the, actually what you are giving, not small dose, what you are giving in the epidural, that itself dissipates into the subarachnoid space. But here you are creating a hole in the dura.
Okay.
That is Dr. Ambarish.
Thank you, Ambarish, for that.
Well done, Arthur. I was following it. You have almost covered everything.
Yeah, thank you very much.
It was refreshing, actually. Well,
that was some of the latest things. Dr. Sanish has also clarified about that. Thank you, Sanish. Any other things? Time to place epidural in obstetric patient can be latent phase of labor. Yes, that is it. That's what I told already. In the latent phase, we place the catheter, but activate it only when it is required, when it is indicated, as per your institutional practice. Right.
What are the
structures? Yeah, that's a latent phase. Okay. Okay, thank you very much. I think we have covered as much as possible, and very good job done by both our postgraduates, Dr. Priya and Dr. Bhuvaneshwari. I think your preparation was excellent. Full marks to your professor, Dr. Mubarak. Thank you, Dr. Mubarak, for chairing the session with me. And hopefully all the audience are benefited by that. And at the same time, I think I should also thank the organizers of this particular program, Dr. Vinil, Dr. Nazar, and Dr. Jitin, who coordinated, Dr. Rajesh. All of you, the entire Kerala is very active, and I wish all the best, the ISA Kerala and the participants, so that most of the students will be benefited in your examinations. Wish you all the best in your future endeavors and your examination.